Good morning, everyone, and welcome to the Join Dota MLG Premier League. We are going to be going into the Southeast Asian Division, Durka.
Oh, yeah.
My first game in Southeast Asia.
Is it?
For this season of MLG, I think it's the first game in Southeast Asia I've covered.
We've been doing Division 2 stuff as well, haven't we?
Yeah. But when it comes to Division 1, the Premier Division, it's going to be our first game, or at least my first game. We're going to be doing G-Guard versus Mineski. Now, Durka, looking over at both of these two teams, I actually feel like it's quite even. Though, betting-wise, people G-Guard definitely siding with G-Guard quite heavily. I think it's a little bit more even than that, but I think in general it's just because the whole scene is a bit unstable. Plus, you got some names on G-Guard that you can't really forget, like KYXY, Net. WTF, Net. You're like, oh, these guys, of course I'm going to bet for them. As far as Mineski go, there aren't really that many of well-known names, right? I mean, you got Jay.
Yeah, pretty much it.
That's kind of it.
The Filipino fans are going to be screaming at you now, like, but these guys.
I know. But if you look at it from an international perspective, most of these guys aren't going to be as well-known. So let's jump into our first game as we have G-Guard versus Mineski. Game one of the two-game series they're going to be going over today. What did Toby do? Oh, man, I didn't even notice this. Toby put on the little mini webcam
picture in picture
thing. Good Lord. All right. Please hold. go ahead, Durka.
You press the key background there. Oh? Or not?
Yeah, that's what I was doing.
10 seconds remaining.
Oh, God, what's he done?
I know, right?
I was so sure it was like key one.
Yeah, that's what I thought, too. It's not working.
Dire team pick, queen.
All right. Well, spooky. we'll figure it out eventually. You go ahead and talk about the draft, and I'll see if I can't fix this.
Well, Lion Batrider and Queen of Pain picked up by G-God there. Batrider, seeing a lot more play in Southeast Asian games, kind of forces the enemy to play a defensive tri-lane. Mm-hmm. Because you don't want to leave that Batrider alone against, you know, squishy support and a melee carry, anything like that. And Gigabyte Mineski, Axe Skywrath straight off the bat. They all want to push this hard. You're still figuring it out?
I have managed to turn it from
camera to black.
I have the right thing here. I just don't know how to make it go away. Reserve time.
What does that on air thing, the red button, do?
Ah! There we go.
Yeah. Oh. Yeah, buddy.
All right, cool. Sorry, guys. Still figuring out we have some cool features that we have kind of figured out and that we're going to be developing more in the studio, so as time goes on, we will have more stuff that we figure out. It's kind of fun, though, having just a little. It reminds me of back in the day. Remember that used to be the thing? Back when streamers were casters, right? Toby Wan was still Toby Wan Dota, and they would have a little camera of Toby in the hero portrait area.
Not anymore.
Reminds me of those days.
Some people
still do it. It's better now. Do they?
Yeah.
I haven't seen any casters do it.
Oh, not.
I'm presuming like some amateur casters, but I haven't even seen like any.
Not big casters, no. Like smaller ones. And you know the stereotype of the sort of girl streamer, where you know takes up 3/4 of the screen with the camera. Yeah. I actually saw a stream. Where they were playing League of Legends. League of Legends took up the background, and then quite literally 3/4 of the screen was her webcam.
Nice.
And then another quarter was the things that pop up saying new subscriber, so you couldn't see any of the game. that was a good stream to watch.
Yeah, that's what some of Twitch is devolving to. But okay, now I can actually look at our draft a little bit better. Lion, Batrider, Queen of Pain, all picked up by G-Guard, Axe, Skywrath Mage, and now the Razor picked up by Mineski. So we have Mineski, who could be going for a lot of like all-in team fight, but G-Guard aren't really lacking any team fight of their own. I was recently looking at a draft from between these two teams, and what I love the fact about G-Guard is that they were their draft. This is from the OK Dota Cup, and they went ahead and drafted like super aggro early to mid game. They had a Night Stalker. right? So, like, that, like, I would love to see Nightstalker come back into the meta again, because that guy's a lot of fun to watch. I mean, he just promotes action. Action, action, action.
We see some teams run it. Well, we see M5 run it in, like, Aggro Troy.
Yeah, some teams, like, some teams, I'm only like thinking one M5, team, really. Yeah.
I was thinking about it, and I thought, I'm sure I've seen two teams, but I remember now that Come With Me was playing it, but he was standing in for M5.
Oh, okay.
So my brain was like, no, it's still the same team. No, but Nightstalker now, he used to be such a strong, dominant mid. Because at the first night, you know, you'd go get a rune, run to a side lane, get a couple of kills, stack up some earned charges, then back to mid. But now, right. I feel he has to be run as a side laner. So either like a solo off laner, so that at the first night, you suddenly come out of the gates and the supports on that defensive tri lane or whatever it is are suddenly surprised. Because you come out with like a burst of power first night.
Right.
Where you can turn things around onto heroes, you know, like Lion, Skyrath, whatever. Or roll one carry, but I don't know if that's his place. There are so many heroes that do that role a lot better.
5 seconds remaining. That being said, he did get some major upgrades to win his aura, right? He got a major attack speed buff from that, right? I think it was the last patch.
I can't remember.
Yeah, don't really talk about too much about Nightstalkers, so.
The last patch I remember was quite some time ago when they changed to night vision on enemy heroes and towers.
Yeah, I'm pretty sure like he gets
a million attack speed.
Yeah, he gets almost 100. Yeah, 90 attack speed is what it says now, and at level 4 during nighttime, the balance change log says Hunter in the Night 6.82 change from 75 to 90.
That's ridiculous.
So, you know, pretty decent chunk upwards. And then before that, it was 6.78 where it increased the base, the level 1 from 30 to 45. So. Yeah, there have been a couple upgrades to that. But yes, I agree. I don't think it's still his place. Like, he would still need another big buff in order to make him, like, a really viable, like, one position. So, the Abaddon now picked up by G-Guard. You think we're going to be seeing dual lanes here from G-Guard? That's usually the way I want to see Abaddon run.
That's what flags for me. Like, Batrider, Abaddon offlane, though? How does that work out?
I actually saw a dual lane of Abaddon, Queen of Pain run by a team recently.
Ooh, that's a good point.
Right, that's a really good lane, but then you would be putting Batrider mid, right? Which is just kind of weird.
Depends who he's up against. So where do you feel his Razor's going? Because he came straight after that quad pick. Mm-hmm. Doesn't do too bad against Queen of Pain, especially very early on in the laning phase.
Yeah.
And if you've got support to move against, Skyrath Mage can come and sit mid and potentially find a kill on that quad with...
Is it bad enough, though, that you feel like Batrider is better versus Razor?
Sniper!
Or Sniper!
Hmm.
Okay. Still maybe the Queen of Pain mid sniper, like the basic setup, the most traditional setup would be defensive tri lane around the sniper, mid Queen of Pain, off lane Batrider.
Yeah.
But I have a feeling that's not what we're going to be seeing here. There's going to be some sort of change up. It's hard to call what.
I think with the sniper pickup, it stays traditional.
Okay.
Because you can have the line and line can sit harassing and Abaddon stacks and pulls or switch round. Mm-hmm. They don't really have a ganging duo. Like, Abaddon doesn't do anything roaming whatsoever.
Uh-huh.
But I don't know, is this a lane to go up against the Axe?
And is this a game for Sniper in general? I mean, there is the Axe, who is a Blink Dagger hero. Everyone else is a bit more mobile. But I was about to say, there's still a fifth pick in the pool. They could easily grab another big jumping hero. Hmm. And sure enough, they do exactly that with the most mobile of all. The Storm Spirit picked up for Mineski as the fifth pick.
I'm just trying to figure out if this sniper pick now was to try and counteract Axe and Dazzle offlane. Because he can just sit at the tower and, you know, plink away at the Dazzle.
That makes sense. But wouldn't there be better... I mean, I feel like there would be better heroes to address that wouldn't be as susceptible to... Like, if you had last pick sniper, like, sure, okay. That's fine. But now you've got the sniper versus facing up against the Storm Spirit. Sure, he's gotten a ban behind him. And that's definitely going to help him out by quite a lot, but it still gives me a bit of concern that that he's just going to be kind of run over, right, by the Storm Spirit and the Axe, both who jump in, the Razor, who's, you know, may not be a blinking hero, but at least he's very fast, right? So, you know, I'm concerned the Sniper is still going to be in some serious danger here. And
it's definitely a threat, but that's only really if the Sniper's left alone. And he's always going to have Abaddon and or Lion close by to save him. Lion's a great hero against initiation heroes. Mm. Simply because the instant cast time on Hex, great against the Axe and the Storm. So they could, you know, turn around an initiation from the Storm if he gets too ballsy and jumps without the rest of his team.
Right.
Batrider with a double ring of protection.
Oh, cuckoo. I mean, he's obviously not in danger of dying here, but if he had stuck around maybe a bit too long, they could have gotten an impale and a shadow strike onto that axe and right-clicked him for a bunch of damage
and
there.
He doesn't want to reveal his ward spot, which is the main reason he backed off. He sees the two heroes and he's like, well, I'm going to be holding onto this observer for quite some time.
Yeah, a lot of players are now, like, they're really making sure that, damn it, Toby. He messed up with the whole entire setup here in the studio.
At least you noticed.
Yeah. It's like all of a sudden I'm like, oh, there's no little box for Dota TV happening. That's because Toby was playing Dota here, so the camo was too fast. And the battle begins. Everything was awful. Way to go, Toby.
He touched things.
Yeah. Stupendous.
Where's that observer ward going? So no observers placed on either offlane by you know, the actual offlaner.
Right.
Just because of the posturing of the enemy team, they've gone really deep. Mm-hmm. Just to stop that, so that's really well played.
Yeah, I was about to say, that seems to be what a lot of players are doing now, making sure that right out the gate, that they, if they're not going to be doing some sort of roaming into the enemy jungle, that they get to a position where they can see where that ward's going to be, and it deters that offlaner from being able to block the camp. So, Jay, starting out, is going to be going up against the sniper here. In the middle lane, that means we have a one-position Queen of Pain faced up against the Axe. Very dangerous lane for the Axe. And we do have the Abaddon with the Batrider here in the offlane. So they're going to try and make this work as best as possible. But, of course, the Razor is still a strong enough laner to be able to force these heroes back pretty damn easily.
It's quite an unusual one. Why would you put the Sniper up against the Storm, do you think? I guess with the Shrapnel change, he does just as well as the Queen of Pain. I'll just feel that Queen of Pain gets such a more favorable lane than the Sniper does.
Yeah, it's a little bit odd. I mean, do you think that the matchup versus, if it was Razor mid as opposed to Storm Spirit mid, say they did something similar that G-Guard
Batrider.
Quap.
Looked like he was in trouble there, but then Net with the Aphotic Shield, always going to save him.
I was about to say, he'd have to get, if anything, I'm expecting him to, like, be able to catch out one of the supports. If they can get to, like, level 2 or 3, if they catch one of the supports, they just run him over, right, with Firefly, Sticky Napalm, and an Aphotic Shield on top, and easily get the kill and perhaps maybe make a trade-off. But I would say for the most part, like, this Batrider really shouldn't be in too much danger, right? It's not really the supports in this lane aren't really that dangerous, primarily because you don't have a real good stunner. Right, so once the Aphotic Shield is blown, there's no, like, disable to be able to stop that person from just running away. A lot of the Southeast Asian team are picking up Dazzle quite a lot. Like, they heavily... Whoa, top lane just caught the Axe falling down on the ground there. He ends up going down to the dual lane of the Lion and Queen of Pain. I was going to say, this is probably the most dangerous lane for anybody, is the Axe versus these two nukers, and both of them have pretty good right-click damage to start with. Lion isn't amazing, but Quap is well-known for being a very strong right-click. Middle lane, Jay. Ling doesn't go for it just yet.
Oh, they've got it.
Yeah, Jay moves back forward, and now he's going to be caught out here. One right-click, follow-up stun, another shrapnel, and they'll easily right-click him down. As WTF is able to claim it thanks to the shrapnel, so two kills up already. G-Guard in a great position here as they've shut down the offlane Axe. They've managed to get a kill on the Storm Spirit, which is the biggest thing of all. Like, if you're going to shut down anybody, Storm Spirit's got to be number one.
Look at what the Axe is doing. I've actually never seen that before. He didn't cut down that tree initially. He was literally just standing there, spinning onto creeps, but he's dead now.
Yeah, he ends up getting a bit too low, and they have this ward. They must have seen this before.
Oh yeah,
and this is a very odd ward to place.
They were pinging him out. Like, he made this move down to the camp, and he just stood there. He aggroed the creeps over the trees and started spinning. Then he cut in with the tango. But yeah, the pings came out. Queen of Pain, more than enough damage. Level 2 Shadow Strike.
So what does that do for you? I mean, if it's melee creeps, they can't reach you, so they have to work around. If it's range creeps, I'm confused. It's just like, why don't you just cut down the regular tree right there
I don't know.
And actually walk in? Like, at first I was thinking, like, oh, it's the proper way to farm camps, right? You know, where how you, like, tuck yourself in a corner versus some camps so the neutrals line up and they're not all hitting you, but you're an axe. Yeah. You want them to hit you. So it's very odd. I'm kind of confused.
You can't choke point.
Something special about that.
You can't choke point jungle against range creeps.
Choke point jungle, that's what it's called. Thank you. Raven, sitting very far forward, is getting pretty much all the last hits in this lane. He doesn't really care about the sticky napalm that's stacking him, just because I think he knows that if they come forward, they just have to use the Skywrath Mage concussive shot, and the Batrider will be too slow to really catch up to the Razor in time.
Where does the Bat go from here? Like, do you buy a bottle as this Batrider, or do you just go into the jungle or get Tranquil Boots and try and farm your Blink Dagger? Assassination on the J.
Yeah, just one of those harassment assassinations.
You're bottling up as well, so why not?
This is what you see a lot of the good mid snipers do, is that the moment they get assassination, they start spamming that out on the enemy. Especially in this case, the best defense is good offense, right? In order to make sure the Storm Spirit doesn't feel safe jumping you, you got to keep them low. And so spamming out assassinates whenever you can is going to be the best way to do so. Especially if you can get them before he's level 6. Because obviously, once he has that ball lightning, he can easily dodge it.
With this safe lane, Quap, that Orchid is going to come out really fast.
Yeah. Especially with the 2 kills that she's picked up already. 34 and 24. Number denies on KYXY is pretty insane here.
Yeah, Axe basically hasn't had a lane. Yeah. He is so sad right now.
You know, I'm just happy that we're seeing KYXY Queen of Pain here. Like, the Queen of Pain is coming back into the meta, but it's always been, for me, a primarily Southeast Asian hero. Like, when Queen of Pain was, like, not being run at all, Southeast Asia was still occasionally picking it up. You know, that's basically their hero.
It was kind of like that with the Puck back in Dota 1 days.
Uh-huh.
It was pretty much just Southeast Asian teams picking it. And then buying Dagon as like first or second item. No one had ever done that before. And now Puck is pretty much a core hero in a large number of drafts, whether it's mid or off lane. Even CIS teams picking it up as a safe lane hero.
Yeah, there's very few games that a Puck isn't banned out or picked nowadays. So between the two, Raven right now, 39 and 19, 43 and 27 on the Queen of Pain. The two safe laners are both getting an extreme amount of farm, but are quite similar to each other. The mid lane matchup, 38 and 11 on the Storm Spirit, while 28 and 3 on the Sniper. I think at this point in time, I'm not sure. I think you have to have your Baton sit behind the Sniper, because he can't feel safe ever moving forward if he's solo in the lane. Just because Storm Spirit's possibility of ganking him plus one support hero, that's a very easy kill on the Sniper.
Yeah, Batrider's going into the jungle, so Baton isn't really needed on that bot lane. He's not needed anywhere, so yeah, why not put him behind the Sniper? Does mean, though, that Razor gets free reign on his bot lane, but it's equal on the opposite side of the map. Both offlaners like, well, kill potential's pretty high right now with Ancient Seal up on that Skywrath.
You know, this is definitely the big downside of, ball lightning, easy. This is the big downside of going for a shrapnel build and spamming out shrapnel. The large number of denies that the enemy hero can get on you. And as you can see, that's the big difference in CS right now. Storm Spirit's up 13 CS, but he's also ahead by 10 denies. And that's solely because the shrapnel just sets him up for free denies on every single range creep, and possibly a couple melee creeps as well. Push in, bottom lane. Raven is starting to chip away at that tower. Compare that to the top lane. KYXY really hasn't put the same kind of pressure, but he doesn't need to. He's just focusing on being able to pick up his Orchid, which is going to come up very, very soon. And at that rate, they're ready to address the Storm Spirit big time.
Yeah, basically two more creeps. The Lion has a smoke prepared for this. So as soon as he gets that, probably just smoke up, head towards mid.
Yeah, it's always the matchup, right? Storm Spirit versus Queen of Pain. The determining factor, they're both snowball heroes. The determining factor is usually who gets their Orchid first. Because at that point in time, like, whoever gets their orchid first immediately goes and tries to address the other hero, shuts them down, delays their orchid, and then that puts you closer to your BKB before they can get their BKB, and it's just a snowball factor. So
yeah.
The Queen of Pain, them prioritizing the Queen of Pain's farm here makes a lot of sense when you know this the timing of your orchid is so critical for being able to shut down the Storm Spirit and keep your Queen of Pain a big factor in this game.
Oh, that TPing bot. The Orchid has been delivered on the courier now as well, so they're going to go aggressive onto this bot lane rather than going towards mid.
Yeah, the teleports in, two-man smoke, KYXY. Plus Link.
Is Lion level 6 yet? No.
No.
I was wondering if they give him a few more creeps up on top lane because he was pretty close.
He can get close enough for the impale. He will be able to get it off. The silence goes down onto KYXY, and he might lose his life from Phonic Shield, and they will be able to blow up the Razor there. As the Assassinate comes in, now extra kills. Yeah. On the lead here, we've got the Dazzle, who's getting quite low, couldn't get off the Shell Grave in time onto the Skywrath Mage. Storm's here, zipping in, but a blink back from KYXY will save him a large amount of HP. As Jay dropping quite low, Dazzle easily taken out. Now Jay is going to be cleanup kill as well, as he fed every bit of his mana there in order to make that jump. And sure enough, WTF assassinates him, and KYXY with the last right click will finish him off for a killing spree. And all that's left is poor Cuckoo here hiding behind the tier 1 tower.
After that Razor kill, it was like, okay, well, Mineski might be able to just back out here. JTP's in, and it suddenly turned into G-Guard wondering, how many can we get here?
Yeah, exactly.
Can we get a full team wipe?
I don't know how he thought that was going to be, like, in what universe was that going to be a good idea for him to actually ball lightning forward there? I mean, once your Razor's dead, it's pretty much all over. I mean, you've got one support that really doesn't do much for you right now. Like, the heals are nice and everything else, but when it comes to offensive action, Dazzle isn't anything for you. And then the Skywrath Mage, well, he doesn't have his ultimate yet, so he doesn't have that big burst of power to be able to take out one hero instantly, so you're automatically fighting 4v5, and you have no chance of evening those odds right away.
Especially when both supports have already used their abilities defensively. Like, oh god, they're jumping on us. Pretty much spam everything. Ancient Seal out. Try to heal up the Razor as much as you can. But yeah, they're going to go for it again, G-Guard. They've got the Blink on the Batrider. Just try and find another pick off on the Razor.
Yep, Raven does manage to at least make sure the tower isn't denied, but he's going to give up his life in the process as the five-man of G-Guard is too strong. WTF now on a dominating spree. Looks like they're going to try and push in to the Tier 1 tower. At the same time, though, Mineski making the better choices this time around. They go for the split push rather than trying to contest G-Guard.
They need to get some big items up faster. Like, Razor needs that mech as soon as possible. They don't really have any level-dependent heroes, per se. So they don't have, like, a Titan to Ravage or something like that, which can just counter-initiate and try and defend towers. They've got Axe, who needs Blink, and he's 300 gold away. So they just need to stay alive for the next 2 minutes or so, dodge fights where they can, maybe give up some support lives, like just throw Skywrath and Dazzle into the fray if G-God get too aggressive, just to save your cause. Because right now, Jay needs to get that Orchid, Razor needs his mech, and Axe needs Blink Dagger. Desperately.
Right. Top tower is under attack. Yeah, the Blink Dagger is definitely, I would say, the keyest factor. And this is what something that I don't particularly like about Axe right now, is that if you don't get that Blink Dagger, I don't feel you're really that effective. Right? You're so dependent on that Blink Dagger, whereas compared to certain offlaners like, you know, the Centaur, like, at least you still have your ultimate. If you're still able to get close enough to somebody, you can burst them down. But Axe, even if you do get close enough to somebody, chances are you're not getting a really good call if you're just walking in. Net runs into the Skywrath Mage here, but of course he is level 7. No chance of anybody killing him here. Jay is setting up for a dive here onto KYXY. This is going to be a bold move if he actually tries to move forward here.
You can't do that.
That's actually impossible.
Level 11 Queen of Pain right now.
Yeah. Maybe if you Access had Blink. Like some sort of nuker like the Skywrath Mage, but Jay is going to be caught out, sure enough. They do have Cuckoo who's going to try and make some sort of response here, but he gets caught by the impale and blown up by the Finger of Death. And that means 0 to 10 now. G-Guard are running away with this game one. Radiant's top tower
is under attack. Pretty much comes down to what you were saying. They got their items faster. Like, the Queen of Pain Orchid has just allowed so many more openings. The TP down to the bot lane shuts down the Razor, who's an integral part of Mineski's basically holding plan. They want the Razor to hold the game for a good 5 or 6 minutes with the mech, push down towers, group up with the Skywrath and the Dazzle and the Axe, and become like an unkillable death ball. while the Storm Spirit goes and finds solo kills, but that just hasn't come to fruition at all.
Radiant's middle tower is under attack.
And then you've got a sniper with phase boots Yasha.
Yeah, it's sad when the Storm Spirit isn't able to just constantly go for the sniper at the very least. Like, the co-op you can understand, okay, she's got Orchid, dangerous hero, but the sniper doesn't have the same kind of responses. But we have yet to see Jay be able to pick off WTF once. And at this rate, he may never be able to. Like, he's gotten all of his stat items for now. If he's able to get that next big item, no matter what it is, it's just going to change. Whether that's, like, the Sange, right, which buffs up the sniper a huge amount. Oh, Jay gets caught out by the disables. They do have the Shallow Grave, and he will survive. I'm not sure if G-Guard, like, just read, okay, they're going to Shallow Grave him. No real sense of going for the kill. But it felt like that was very little commitment by G-Guard. They just kind of sat back, then a couple of pot shots from the sniper. Like, yeah. The Abandoned didn't run forward. The Lion didn't stick around for more right clicks.
They jumped in, Impale, Hex, Assassinate, and then, oh, he's still alive. Well, we don't see any of the Radiant heroes, so it's time to back off. Lasso on spot lane.
Ghost jumps in, and you do have KYXY. He could get off a big ultimate here, but now he throws in not quite enough to kill anybody, and KYXY is going to lose his life finally. Maneski get themselves on the board. As a little bit of four-manning is what it takes to find some G-Guard kills.
But what was Batrider doing? Like, he didn't have vision there. He just fireflied over the trees. Like, oh, look, there's a target. Let's jump on that guy.
Yeah, I guess, I bet they would have figured is that, like, oh, they just saved the Storm Spirit middle. They're probably not going to be here in this bottom lane in time. So whoever I grab, like, it's only going to be two, maybe three heroes at most, but... little did he know, Maneski made the instant rotation to the bottom lane, and we're definitely there in time.
Yeah, I guess you expect Axe to be still farming the jungle or something like that, and Dazzle's still sitting mid.
Do you agree with the mech pickup here from the Razor?
I think they needed to do it. Yeah. Like, after his first death, that's what he bought up. Like, he had phase boots, Aquila, and magic stick. And then he died that one time in bot lane, and he just bought, like, the majority of mech. Mm-hmm. And... I don't know. If he went stat items, what would he actually bring to the table? Like, if he just went straight into BKB, it would take too long. If he went drums, it wouldn't really offer anything.
Oh, Ling, what was that? That was,
he was saying hello.
That was YOLO as hell.
Hi, Jay. Yeah. How you doing?
Yeah, I don't know. I don't know what the plan was there. Like, sure, he can disable Jay in order to make sure the assassinate hits there. The sniper wanted to let that one go, but then what do you do? Didn't really have enough burst damage to be able to take down the Storm Spirit. Now, KYXY is setting up for a kill onto Raven here. Throws out the Stifling Dagger, but the counter is instantly there. KYXY is going to be blown up by the Axe and the Skywrath Mage, and now the chase continues here. Net is going to have an Aphotic Shield helping him out here, and they do have a bit of a turnaround. Sure enough, the Batrider pulls up Raven onto the cliff. Excellent start here. He does have a mech, and he'll live for a while. As you can see, Cuckoo's just kind of chasing away that sniper. Raven, bit by bit, is dying, as we do have the Dazzle trying to keep him alive, but a burst damage will be able to take him out. Now Ghost, he's taken out by the Storm Spirit, bounce back, and heals Net, keeping him alive. WTF. Cuckoo looks like he's going to be surrounded and easily taken down. Tries to go for the Skywrath Mage, but Shallow Grave will keep him alive for the time being and might be taken out here. Ling is moving forward, trying to go for Cuckoo. Blows him up with a Finger of Death. Meanwhile, Skywrath Mage is chased down by the Batrider. Ling going for the next kill. It's going to be the Dazzle hexed up. Net will be catching up here. No levels in his passive, but with this Batrider there, it doesn't really make much of a difference, as they'll easily have enough damage to burst him down. And sure, at the end of the day, the sniper does go down. They picked off the Queen of Pain, who is now jumping on a Jay. Orchid, and with an ultimate landing, that is going to be an instant kill from the Orchid. Full wipe. Full wipe, Turkid. Started off looking really terrible for Maneski, but as time went on, that net worth advantage that G-Guard had was just too much.
The Abaddon, though, that is the key. Like,
oh,
he just kept the fight going and going. Miss coils, aquatic shields. How did he have enough mana just to use... He's got Sol Ring and Magic Wand, okay.
Yeah.
But he just kept spamming spells the entire time. Like, the sniper should not have lived that long. And the fact that the miscoil happened as the Culling Blade was landing from Axe meant that he could survive for another 5 or 6 seconds during that fight. So much attention was thrown onto that sniper where the Batrider and the Lion were doing a lot of damage on the side. Mm-hmm. But KYXY has been getting a little bit too aggressive. He doesn't have BKB yet. Nearly gets
cold. Oh, Batrider's actually going to grab him here, but KYXY has nothing. He's got no mana whatsoever. He's just going to Orchid and mid that Assassinate. Maybe they can kill him. Flame Break, and yep. One last right click from the Queen of Pain is enough to secure that kill.
No grade from the Dazzle.
Yeah, maybe
out of range? Top tower
is under attack. I don't think so. With level 4 Shallow Grave, I don't think you're ever out of range. That's kind of interesting that he... I mean, it makes sense in this game. You have to play very defensive. But yeah, just the straight up maxed out levels of Shallow Grave and Shadow Wave as soon as possible. Not even a level of Weave yet.
Does Jay have Orchid yet? He's got 2 Oblivion Staff. Needs that recipe.
He desperately does, but there's... So I was going to wonder, like, is it going to be SNY for the Sniper? This will tank you up and everything, but I almost feel like Manta is the better tanking up item because of the fact that, like, yeah, you'll get more strength out of SNY, but Manta gives you the counter to...
Ancient Seal.
To Ancient Seal, but I was also thinking the Orchid from the Sniper, or from the Storm Spirit. Like, you know that's going to be coming up eventually, so if you can get ahead of that by getting yourself a Manta, I feel like that's the better play. Even though I don't particularly like Manta on Sniper.
Sniper's one of those weird heroes, though, where... Oh, last hero onto Jay.
Yeah, Jay. Point-blank assassination. That is rough.
Execution style.
Yep. Oh, KYXY forced to pop his BKB. Speaking of which, he has a BKB.
But yeah, when you look at heroes like, let's say, Ember Spirit, for instance, he's got escape mechanisms or spells that he wants to get off in a team fight. Whereas Sniper doesn't really worry too much about the silence effect of Ancient Seal or Orchid. And the damage afterwards isn't going to be a big deal now he's got Sanjin Yasha. So I think SNY is probably the best item to go for. I just don't feel he's a hero that needs to debuff silences.
Yeah, yeah, well, I definitely agree. Like, the silence factor is not that much for me. I feel like it's just the extra 15% damage from the Orchid. Like, I feel like if you can... Or, sorry, 30%. If you can negate that... by having a Manta for yourself up against that Storm Spirit. Like, I feel like in 1v1, and the Storm Spirit jumps you, what's going to make you live longer, the SNY or the Manta? And I personally feel like it's the Manta just because you can get rid of Orchid. But I can definitely see, like, why an SNY would be his item choice here. I mean, oftentimes he's going to be paired up with Baden anyway, so it's not like he even has to worry about getting rid of Orchid himself.
And does Jay even have that Orchid? Is that one more creep and he's got it? Needs a bit more gold. He's got a regen rune, which is pretty nice as well.
Smoke up. They're trying to bait out the Storm Spirit. Little do they know, though. Well, they know now. Roshan dies, and the Queen of Pain is going to be the one picking up the Aegis. So time to set up for that gank. Whoever TP's up to the top lane is going to be taken out, but it doesn't look like anyone from G-Guard is going to take that bait. Now, they are going to run directly into this smoke, but it's Net leading the charge, and that's probably the best way, but the Axe in the background is able to grab 2. Ling, surviving for a while, is able to get off his Hex. He's about to go down here. Net, silenced up for too long, couldn't save his ally. Meanwhile, we have Ghost, who's going to be dragging Raven to the side, putting him in a bad position while KYXY cleans up the mess. We've got Skywrath Mage, he goes down. Dazzle also taken out. Jay, as well as the Razor here. The last 2 left alive, but it doesn't look like there's going to be anything to stop them from just running themselves away and TPing out. So, in the end, it is a 2-for-3 exchange there in the favor of G-Guard, but not a bad fight for Mineski, all things considered. Consider, like, how far behind they are. Like, that fight could have gone so much worse.
That was super disjointed, though. Like, the Queen of Pain going to the Tier 1 tower and being completely cut off from the rest of her team, then meets Jay in the middle of the jungle and is like, hey, Jay. Jay uses Orchid onto the Quap, who just BKBs and blinks into the middle of the fight. So the Storm Spirit really didn't have any effect whatsoever. Orchid was wasted, couldn't ball lightning in to actually do any damage. So it was kind of a 4v5 for Mineski there, and judging by that, that fight went very well for them.
G-Guard, let's see. BKB soon on Ghost's Batrider. We've got a Mask of Madness now for the Sniper. BKB up on the Razor. The BKB is definitely a very important item. Even though the Queen of Pain... Do you think you should be going Axe here? Like, obviously, the Orchid is your first item, and I feel like most of the time it's either Orchid or Axe, but not both, because they're both kind of like middling items. Mm. You know, I don't feel like they're give you a whole lot of late-game potential as the Quap. But in this game, going up, you know you're going to be facing some BKBs. Do you think Aghanim's would have been better as a secondary item as opposed to, I'm presuming, which is Scythe of Ice?
Well, Quap's ulti goes through immunity regardless of Ags.
True.
So I don't think you really need it too much. Ags basically allows you to spam it on creep waves and cycle it with other teamfight ulties. And since they don't have anything like, you know, a Chronosphere from Void or Epicenter from Sand King, they don't really need that Queen of Pain ultimate to just keep coming off cooldown every, what, 40 seconds.
Right.
So I think Hex here is good, so you can silence someone like the Dazzle or the Skyrath with the Orchid. Try and silence them so the Grave and Heal and spells from Skyrath don't come out. And then Hex up the Storm so he dies so much faster.
WTF, he just keeps bringing more and more items to a ball. That's just a TP scroll. They run out to the side lanes. KYXY dealing with the top lane push, bottom lane push. Going to be cleaned up by WTF here.
I mean, this ultimate orb could potentially be, you know, Skadi or Lincoln's.
That's true. I was thinking, like, eh, it's Lincoln's possible here, but I figured since he already has BKB middle lane, Batrider going to be jumped on. They will blow him up. It looks like no! Nice little four staff. He's going to be able to keep him alive for the second, but now you have the Storms here. Running him over. Cuckoo is taking a lot of damage on the left side. We do have our Skywrath Mage, who's going to be the next victim of G-Guard. Jump forward. Oh, big ultimate coming out. They finish off the Axe. First Skywrath Mage is going to be taken out by the Abandon, while KYXY finally claims that secondary kill. Now fighting up against the Dazzle with teleport away. You do have, oh, sure enough, they do manage to get that small little mini stun to stop him. And they do claim the Dazzle. Oh no, Stormsphere completely out of mana too, and that's gonna be a full wipe there in exchange for a smoke gank on the Batrider.
6-0-3 on this Abaddon. What? What's going on? First half of the fight, he's spamming his spells defensively, healing off his team, then halfway through realizes, hang on, all my team's on full HP. I don't need to be using these defensively anymore, just using Mist Coil to take kills.
What was the mini stun?
Assassination.
Oh.
The actual hit from Assassination is a mini stun now.
I was like, a headshot doesn't mini stun anymore, no. So I was so confused, but...
I just said mini stun for the sake of it.
I was just like, I just ran with it. I was like, I mini stun.
Radiant structures are fortified.
Oh... No, I don't know what you do here as Mineski. I mean, it seems like every single one of their... Like, they're making the right plays. Well, this one's not
they're
right
They're just so far behind.
Yeah, they're just... Like, that play, the smoke gank, that was a good start to the team fight here. This team fight up in the enemy jungle, like, that was good. They had an Axe, like, two-man call, and they got a pretty decent Skywrath Mage ultimate off of that. Like, that was a great way to start the fight. The middle lane, smoke gank onto the Batrider, like, not too bad, but... It's the right way they're going about looking for these engagements. It's just they're so far behind that they can't even win them. And it is a Lincoln's for the Queen of Pain.
I thought it might be. Defensiveness, always a priority for Quap. Bye, Storm Spirit.
All right. And I love the fact that the Lion just casually goes right back up to full mana. This Lion is so incredibly good. Like, before, Lion was always good versus Storm Spirit because the Blink, long duration Hex. Jump into the middle lane here, but they're going to rebuffed by the Razor. We do have a really good stun there from the Lion. As from the low ground, KYXY and WTF do manage to get off a couple of pot shots. Orchid plus Assassinate is not going to be enough to finish off the Dazzle.
But BKB and Mech have both been used. Whereas G-Guard pretty much on full HP, full mana. Very few of them need to go back, so they can continue the siege. Like, KYXY is the only one that might be worried, but he's got Lincoln's to keep his regen going. Right. He's got the Abaddon to keep going.
Cuckoo. Messed up on that Blink Dagger. Had an opportunity to maybe grab the Sniper and a couple of creeps, but doesn't quite get it. Good silence there from the Skywrath Mage. Will be able to push back the Batrider, and G-Guard will bounce themselves out of here as the Storm Spirit is reviving. But yeah, this is... That's right. The Lion was always good versus the Storm Spirit way back in the day, like the Blink. This is back in the day when you'd have like core Lion with Weapon X.
Mid Lion.
Yeah, the Mid Lion. And like it was just trash. It was just trash, the Storm Spirit, every single time. He's a low HP hero, really susceptible to the double disables that Lion has. Very easily kills him. But nowadays, it's made even worse because Mana Drain has been buffed up so many times that now you can take away all his mana, too. Four-man smoke. Batrider is on the precipice of being able to pop that smoke from the left side. They're going to be able to grab this sniper, maybe. They need to jump him soon. Sure enough, they grab him and try to blow him up. The Skywrath Mage Ultimate kind of whiffing there as WTF managed to stay one step ahead. Now Jay is running low on mana. Shalgrave, not quite enough. Is he unable to get the kill onto the sniper? Farther up, we do have the Skywrath Mage. Oh, my God. That was just spitting on him. That was disgusting.
Oh, Skywrath Mage, you're on 50 HP, huh? Well, here, take this 700 damage nuke to the face.
Yeah, I could literally right-click on the same amount of time it takes to kill you. But instead, you just got this Skywrath Mage who's in critical condition. This guy's, like, on his deathbed in a coma.
His knees are broken. He's in a coma. He's got, I don't know, Ebola or something. He's in a hospital, and then Lion just comes in, puts a pillow over his head.
Yeah, takes a shotgun to his face. Not just a pillow. A pillow would be subtle. A pillow would be a right click.
No, he picks up a pillow, and there's a shotgun in the pillow.
Okay, fair enough. All right, so we have our mid laner action is going to be falling here. G-Guard. Ooh, what a rough game. 8-32.
Well, it was like 12-0 at one point.
Yeah.
I don't know, Mineski have... Like you said earlier, they've done some nice moves to try and bring it back, and it's always this really weird situation where, okay, tactically they're correct, but overall the decision-making is wrong because they're behind, and they know they're behind.
Right.
So if they're making these moves to try and find pickoffs, it's a bit of Mineski feeling a little bit, you know, desperate to get these kills on G-Guard, mm-hmm. but also G-Guard grouping up. They know that they've got the potential to just turn these fights around. They don't have to split push the map because they're not dealing with a Naga or Anti-Mage, something like that. There's no threat to their towers or their base. So they don't have to spread thin. They can just group up as three or five, like they have been the majority of the game, and deal with any kind of pickoff potential that Mineski throw at them.
Do you ever worry about building too many mid-game items?
What, are you looking at the Ags on Quop?
I'm looking at the, like, that as well as the Sniper, right? Who went for, like, SNY, mid-game item. Mask of Madness, early to mid-game item. And then, like, is so far ahead, like, he could be getting, like, a really big late-game item. Instead, he goes for the Maelstrom's Mjolnir, which I would say is more of a mid-game item. The Queen of Pain, who, you know, BKB, Orchid, Lincolns, Aghanims. All mid-game items. I mean, granted, it's only 31 minutes into the game, so obviously, and there's no chance that G-Guard are going to be losing this game. They would have to throw extremely hard, but just as a general concept, do you think it's ever a problem building too much mid-game and not making that transition into going bigger late-game items?
Well, both of them have gone mid-game items for, like, team fighting, sustainability, and survival. So, right. Like, the Sniper went Mask of Madness, Sanjin Yasha Mask of Madness for the damage output, but also to tank up a bit. Then Queen of Pain has gone BKB, Orchid, Lincolns for pretty much the same reason. Mm-hmm. Now, the Ags and the Mjolnir are mid-game items, but the main factor for them here is to push creep waves faster. So they just want to put as much pressure onto Mineski right now as they possibly can, and don't let them leave the base.
Right, so you're just kind of going all in on, okay, guys, we are definitely hitting peak. For the next 10 to 15 minutes, there is pretty much no chance that Mineski can contest them because these mid-game items are just too strong. Batrider actually does manage to grab Jay here, pull him back into the impale, blow him up with the Finger of Death. Cuckoo is managing to draw the attention of the Queen of Pain, but it's only going to do so much. The ultimate still goes off onto two there as Cuckoo and Raven are both going to be forced back, and they continue to beat down that tier 3 tower. The rest of Mineski are forced back to the fountain.
Oh man, Jay had just picked up his BKB and then has no buyback, gets jumped by the Batrider lasso before he can use it.
Second set of racks soon to fall as Mineski looking for an opening here, but it's going to be the Lion who makes the jump first. Impale onto the Razor, stunning him up as long as possible. Meanwhile, they focus Cuckoo down. Now the Shalgrave is down, and oh man, super close. The Razor almost dying there, but again, G-Guard get what they can, back up, finish off the base, then reinsert once again with Link. Two-man stun, and a flame break. That was just beautiful there. Three heroes fall. And now, maybe finally, Mineski will call the GG, as 8-37 seems surely a lead that is insurmountable. G-Guard completely outclassing their opponents here in game number one.
Oh, no, you can't call GG now. You've got to let Jay respawn, use his BKB, try it. Yeah, there we go. He does it. He's using BKB. He's trying to find a kill.
Oh, get the kill.
Come on, you can do it.
Oh my god, he's out of mana. He can't get the kill.
Another turnaround. Yeah. Hex dead.
Just drain whatever little, just the tiniest little bit of mana that's left on that poor Storm. All right. I guess they had their fun.
Premature GG call. Like, you kind of know that's going to happen. You just want that Storm... The Storm Spirit wants to come back to life. Use that BKB just one time.
Yeah, completely understandable. Now, I classify this as a total outclass here by G-Guard in Game 1. Now, how much do you think that is really true? And how much do you think it's just simply the snowball factor? That G-Guard made the right decisions, right? Putting the Queen of Pain in the safe lane, getting her that Orchid that much faster. Do you think it really is just that snowball factor? They made the right decisions, and that's why it's such a dominant game? Or do you think that G-Guard are just like... just one level above, like one, maybe even two or three levels above Mineski?
I think skill-wise, they're probably, like a level and a half above Mineski, but pretty much the entire game, like you said, came down to that Queen of Pain safe lane. Mm-hmm. I mean, you mentioned it very early on. The matchup between Quap and Storm early to mid-game, who gets Orchid first, and then who gets BKB fastest after Orchid.
Right.
So the Queen of Pain got, Orchid at 9 minutes or... something ridiculous like that, 8.5
really
minutes.
Really
TP to bot lane, shut down the Razor, so there was no mech. There was no actual way for Mineski to hold onto the game and allow Storm to catch up. So everything's just snowballed from that one quad placement on top lane.
All right, guys. Well, we are going to be getting ourselves into game number 2. Short little break, and we'll be back with the second game of G-Guard versus Mineski.